in making something here in the machine shop with our little miniature milling machine from Sherline, we cannot see what we can normally see with the rotary table when we're going to do the operation that we have to do. Now, right now, when you look at the rotary table, you can actually see the zero point I'm pointing to, and you can also look above the little handle for the rotary table, and you can see the zero right there too. And there's a little line right up here. All of that's visible. But suppose you have to do just what we're going to do, which is take a sort of piece that's very large on top of the rotary table. So now, when this is on here, if I were to fasten it down, there's no way to see the dial. You can look under there low enough and you can see where the zero is, but you can't actually see the degrees in between. So that's an issue. The other day, I did a quick and dirty little dial. It's not real nice around the edge, although the numbers aren't too bad. And threw it on the front of here and fastened it down. And then you can actually see what's on the back of the dial on the front of the dial. Nice little feature. Well, like I said, I did it quick and dirty. Did it real fast. Got it done. It works. But I actually don't like how it looks. Up here, I took a little magnet and it's hot melt glued with a wire that allows you to see where the zero point is up above. So you'd have it here, and you have the zero painted in red. And so when this little dial's on the front, again, you can actually see zero right there, which works out really nice, except the dial looks kind of crummy. And I made the numbers too small, so I'm not real happy with it. So what we're going to do is show you how to make a really nice one, and with nice numbers and good size. So that's what this video is going to be about, is how to make one of these really good right here in the shop. All right, so we're here in my office at the house, looking at how we're actually going to make this part, or how I made part of it before. And what we have is a very old desktop computer. The nature of the age of the computer is important because we actually have to use a certain version of AutoCAD to talk to the laser cutter that we have, which we'll see in a little bit. So as a consequence, I'm using an old version of Windows and an even older version because I'm running a virtual machine for 98 SE of all things. So I can use the version of AutoCAD I want and do certain things on the machine to actually make that disk. Okay, so like I was saying, I don't like the height of the numbers. They're too small. So we're going to change the number size here by changing the properties. It gives me a ridiculous number. But what I'm actually going to do is go to 3/16 of an inch. So that makes my zero here real big. And I'll move my zero so he's where I'd like him to be instead of being off in the middle of nowhere. And we're going to zoom this down 0.9x. And maybe zoom it again 0.8x. I'm just wanting to get to where I can see it a little nicer, make sure I put the number where I want it. So the number's down there. So that's changed to 3/16. And you see the difference between the zero and the other numbers. So that was one of the things wrong with the dial. So I'm going to go around and change the other ones to 3/16. So we got all that set up. Now I choose my file name and I'd actually save it. So what I'm going to save it to is going to be really surprising. In the 21st century, I'm going to save it to a 3.5 floppy disk because that's what the computer that runs the laser requires. Is I've got to transfer by a floppy disk. It won't do me any good to try to do a, you know, a modern thumb drive. Doesn't work. We don't have a Wi-Fi connection to it. We do not have a local area network for it. We carry it over there with a floppy disk. But for what we're doing on the computer, just letting it run a laser cutter, that's fine. So right now, that's what we're going to do, and then we'll be back with you when we show you what we do with the next step. So to make them round, we converted the Sherline lathe back to a lathe. And we're going to start with the idea of actually facing off a little piece of brass we've got here, 3/8 brass, that we're going to use to make a little custom mandrel to actually hold a disc of aluminum and turn a disc of aluminum that's actually worth using instead of having a second-rate piece, which, like I said, I hacked it out. I knew I did that. I was in such a hurry to get the item so I could actually work with it. I didn't worry about whether or not I did a good job on making it pretty. I just made it function. Well, this one we're going to make pretty and function. All right. Sherline miniature lathes work really well for making small parts. You don't need to have a giant machine to make small parts all the time. Now we've got it fairly tightened up because I've also been using it as a mill, and that's going to prove to be too fast. Turn on our digital readout, and we're going to turn that down. Maybe try in here about 1100 and see how we are. We're just going to start by facing off the end of this because this is just a half-sawed piece of metal, and I don't want a rough end, obviously. So we've just sort of touched the end, and we're going to just gradually work this down until we get what we want. There we go. I thought it was a little crooked. There's nothing fancy about doing this. We're just going to look at it occasionally. Get rid of the end of it. And we'll flip it around and we'll actually do the opposite end. So we have a decent piece to start with. Didn't go all the way to the center. But as you can see, if you look right at the end, I haven't got it quite all the way yet. Nice smooth end is what we're after. Using a little carbide tip cutter here just to finish this off reasonably quickly, and a little bit more. There, I think we got it. One of the things I find with this is don't hack off large pieces. It doesn't work out well, especially since you got nothing out here supporting it. So we got the end nice. So now we're going to flip it around, we're going to get the opposite end, which will make things look real nice for making the dial. And this end is particularly rough. This is the one I just hacksawed off. So again, we're just facing the end of it. The only thing I used the DRO for was just reading the speed on the lathe for a moment, because I haven't been caring about what I'm doing, but getting the ends faced off. Got what I want off. Okay, so we got both ends faced off. Next, gonna have to put back on my tailstock. The tailstock's been off the lathe because I was using it as a mill base. So we got our tailstock back in place on here, so we're gonna be able to center drill. Move this up roughly in the position I want. Get out a center drill. And eventually we're gonna drill and tap the end of this all the way in just a moment. All set, and grab the oil here, oil on the end of things, and we'll come in, we'll center drill our brass rod here. Oh, I don't have this quite tight enough. Tighten it up a little bit. Oh, that's better. There we go. And we're just center drilling our rod. That worked real good. So now we got a point to work with. We'll take out our center drill that we don't need anymore. Shut that off momentarily. Center drills work so well to keep things from walking. Put the center drill away. Now we're going to get a 1032 tap drill. So this little set of drills happens to list it right on here, so I can look up and I have a 21. So we'll find a 21. There's 21. So the drill's out of the way. Take our number 21, we'll move our tailstock out of the way. Now we're not going to have to drill as long as the screw I've got here, because what we're going to end up with in the end, I have a screw with a 1032 nut that I've got. And we've got a couple of pieces of square aluminum, not really square, more like trapezoids, but whatever. They're big enough to do what we need to do, because we needed them bigger than the dial. So they're both bigger than the dial, that's all I care about at the moment. And what we're going to do is we're going to drill in here, we're going to tap that 1032, and we're going to take our two pieces of aluminum and basically clamp them together and drill a hole in them, and then we will screw them on with our screw on the end of our little rod to make our mandrel here. And the mandrel, as you can see, is kind of long right now, but I can put it back into the lathe, which is fine. I may decide to cut it off after a bit. But right now we're going to put our tap drill in the end of that rod. Oh, not quite tight enough. I'm going to tighten again. I thought I got that. There we go. Now it's tight enough. I'm going to use a little bit more oil here. And it's just a nice little drilling operation. I just want to get enough of a depth that I can deal with my screw. If necessary, I'll cut the screw off. I'd love to have one a little bit shorter, and I can cut it off. I just didn't happen to have a little bit shorter one laying around today. There it goes. Crash here. I'm going to make it a little bit deeper yet. I don't have a bottoming tap, so I also want to make the hole deeper than I want to tap it. Okay, now we're just going to do a little guesstimating about how much material we've got. So I got my little nut, and I've got my screw, I got my two pieces together. That tells me between the screw head and the nut, that would get the two pieces of aluminum. So I would like to have from the screw down, the nut down, to be deep enough. So we'll make a little check here and see how deep we really are. Okay. I don't know if you all noticed that. This little piece moved just a little bit, but that little piece tells me I'm deep enough. So I could use that piece of brass scharf and look at it. So we're deep enough to actually do our tapping here. We're going to take this back out of the way again. Now right now, we have to tap it so we can put our pieces on there. So we will take our chuck out of here, and I'm actually going to take it out of here and tap it, because it's going to be too hard for me to mess with it in here. So I'll just take the piece out, tap it, and we'll be back doing stuff in a few minutes. Here we have our little mandrel that we turned so far. Tap 1032, shortened the 1032 screw, little stainless slot screw I had. And we have our two pieces of aluminum, which have now been hacked down and sanded a bit, so they're sort of headed towards round, so that we can put a little piece of aluminum between them in the end. So that's what we've got. And we're going to set that up in the lathe. And we're going to turn these down to the right size. First of all, we're just pretty much roughing this thing, because we've got to get it down quite a bit. We're going to put it way up by the chuck. Right there, there we go. just screw them down to circles. So, obviously we didn't get a circle, but we took off a bunch of material. Head in the right direction, cutting nicely. I'm going to zero my X, just so I know how much I'm feeding in at a time. We're going in 4 thousandths. I know it's not a lot, but I'd rather do this slow for a moment to make sure everything comes out. Okay, we're good, so we'll go to about 6 thousandths in on this cut. We're going to do about 6 thousandths at a time. That's doing nice. Speed slightly. Real small lathes, it seems to help a lot to go a little bit faster than normal. And you see we're getting more round all the time. You can also see where we have flats still. That black line I drew on there is more or less a fat outline of what we want. Some of this, I don't want it flying in my face here in a minute. There we go. So you see we're getting more and more round. And if we take our little disc, we look at the disc here. See, we are getting more towards where we want to be. And the disc actually fits on there. I checked that before we started. Here less and less where it's missing from the blank spots. Looking better. All of it now. Just a couple of little spots left here. And we still are outside the size, just comparison of our disc. I just do a little. Cleaned up all the way around. This little stuff on the back we can knock off here with a file. Not fitting the chuck too much. So cleaned up that side. Maybe a little chamfer on this side. All right, so there, I have cleaned up for the most part. See, I've got a little burr back here that I wouldn't brush. There we go, all cleaned up. So what we have is a mandrel that'll fit our dial. And the truth is, if the dial's just slightly long, larger than the mandrel, it's actually good because I want it just barely larger than the mandrel. If we have it too much larger, when we go to turn the dial exactly round, what's going to end up happening is the dial will bend on the edge, and we don't want that. Put it down. So I want to back up just a little. I tighten it in a little vise here, so that I can actually take it apart. And right now it doesn't surprise me, the two little discs kind of stick together a little bit. So there are two discs. This would go in the center. And this, of course, is our rough finished one we made before. And the reason we're 1032 is that's the size that fits for everything here. But you see the disc sandwiches in between. The idea is when we make our next disc, we'll use this to hold the material and we'll turn it to the size that way. And that's why we can turn something that's a flat piece of material. So we've got our mandrel, we've got our two discs, and here we have a little disc of aluminum. Notice we made it larger than the old bad one. We punched a center hole in it, which is for a 1032. We're going to stick that between the two discs, put our screw through all of that, and then we're going to screw it back together here. We're going to screw that down tight. Okay, so get that tight. We're going to mount the mandrel back in the lathe and turn down that little disc. And you see why I went to all the trouble making the mandrel, because if we didn't make the mandrel, we wouldn't have been able to turn that disc to the size we want to have it. So, this is mostly a by eye thing. Just want to turn down the disc. I'm taking real light cuts, just getting rid of the excess material on this. So we're getting close to having it all the way around. Probably going to leave it a little proud here of the actual mandrel. So let's see what we got. See how it looks when it's out of the machine. Okay, so we got a little ring all the way around it, and I'm going to see if I like it that way. I don't like it quite that way. Eventually we'll get back up to it. There we go. Okay, now this time we should pretty much have what we want. Take it out. We're going to put it back in our vise. And reset it there so we can get it undone. Nice and tight here. Get our screwdriver out. Disc out. So there's the assembly, everything out of here. And we got our round disc that we were after. And we'll just get rid of the stuff on the back of this dial. We don't care about the finish on the back of the dial, we just don't want to have that piece of flashing on it. Filing is sometimes the best thing to do, and you might notice I don't drag the file back and forth. It's kind of an amazing thing. It's one of the first things I'm told they used to teach people when they were working in machine shops. You had to learn how to file. You'll also notice I got a burr in the center here to get rid of. So I'll get rid of that too. That's from when it was punched. The punch probably isn't quite as sharp as it could be. So let's go through and get rid of most of that, so we don't have it to bother us when we put this on the machine later. So you can see we got rid of all that pretty much. I'm just going to do a little rotating. I'm barely pressing on this file. I'm just taking off anything that's on here we don't want. This disc will now fit on the front of there. Obviously, as long as I've got the post there and I don't have the other hole, we can't stick it on. But compared to our first disc and our second disc, there's a huge difference. I'll set them here on the little desk. You know, the funny thing is this is a kiddie's desk that my daughter picked up at some time, and I reworked it to do this. Who cares what it looks like? It does the job. But you notice this one wasn't round. This one's dead on round. This is because I did it the quick cheat method. This is because I did it the way I should have, with a mandrel and everything, but I was trying to get it done the day I did it and not trying for pretty. Today we're going to do it pretty, because this one is a little hard for me to read with the small numbers anyway. So in a moment, we'll go on to the next step. All right, so here we're going to just take ordinary fiber thinner, cheapest I can get a hold of. That's all you ever need for that. And all I'm doing is just wiping off the side we're going to paint ultimately. It's also the side that had our little black marker on it, and I took everything off. So the lacquer thinner has gotten rid of that. All right, what we have here is a little air eraser by Pache. We also happen to have Pache air eraser compound. That's aluminum oxide in this case. And what this amounts to is a miniature sandblaster. And we're just going to quickly work on etching the surface. Like I said, it doesn't have to be perfect. You just want to have something for tooth for the paint. All right, so we got Krylon Dual Super Bond paint and primer. And this happens to be black satin. And we're going to just give our little piece a coat of paint. Now, I just sprayed it once. That's not enough paint. But if I spray it two times right now, it's going to be too much paint. And what's going to end up happening is it's going to end up being too thick and it'll run or something. So it'll get a couple of coats. So that's really all you need to see, is that that's what we're going to use for paint. We're going to give it a couple of coats and let it dry a little bit. We're going to fire up another little piece of equipment that we have here that we use for special purposes. At one time we used it to make miniature items for model railroads. And what it really is a laser cutter, which was built essentially here. It doesn't have enough power to cut aluminum, that's why we spun our disc beforehand. In order to cut the disc though, we're going to cut a piece of chipboard first and prove where it's going to actually cut it. So now when I turn it on, it's going to get noisy.
most of what we were doing there was really just setting up to cut the paint right off our aluminum disc. All right, so now we're setting the disc in. Making sure we got the same spot we had chipboard. Everything's down. Table back real carefully. So hopefully I don't move anything. I'm going to try to shoot on the disc. That's what it looks like right now, which makes it look like, oh, you can't even read it. So now we gotta go do another little step to it. All right, so we went back to the other main garage, took our disc, which has been through the laser cutter, and we're gonna clean off the burned paint. I'm gonna just use a little water, a little Dawn dish soap of all things. And we're gonna rub on our little disc here. And all of a sudden, magically, we have numbers on our little disc. And you can see that we get a number system on here like we wanted to have. We've washed our little disc with Dawn dish soap and water. As you can see, they're all the numbers and everything that we were after. Looks beautiful. Looks absolutely production, made on the laser cutter. Now you notice there's a little circle there with an X. That circle's for that second pin. I only punched the center before to turn it. Now I gotta punch where that little X is. And that's sort of tricky. It's almost a three-handed job. I'm gonna see if I can see it well enough to get it done here. And I can't. So we're gonna switch buildings and go where I've got more light. Okay, I've gone up here to the machine shop where I've got more light. Still got my little X to deal with. Punch that. Maybe. See, it creates just a little burr when it punches. And that's what I'm fighting here. I got a lot more movement, but still I'm having trouble just getting it off of there. Got it. So it took a little effort, but it's off. So there you have one completely finished little disc with all the information you want on it. So it'll match up exactly to the rotary table. Okay, there's only one way for this to go on, since we've already got one post on here. So we'll just hang it on there and let it fall for a minute. Then we will take our center screw and washer.
bring this back up and put this together. We need a right-down wrench for that. So we're remounting our center screw. And then we're going to remount our little handle, which goes right here, thusly, and its little screw, which takes a Phillips back in there. And there you have when you're done, a 100% professional. We have zero on the rotary table, zero on our hand wheel, and zero on the front of the hand wheel all at the same time. And it looks exactly like factory. It's got a little dust on it right now. You know, I've got a little dust here, but I can blow the dust off and wipe it off, and it looks like it came with it. I think that's pretty cool. When we finished up making the disc for the front of the rotary table, I had mounted a little magnet and a wire with hot melt glue. And the disc on the front, the dial, was way too nice and decided, oh, let's get serious. So what's been done to add a pointer for it is on the mill here, I actually drilled a tap hole for a 1032. Tapped this particular piece of the rotary table. Cut down a screw so it doesn't go all the way through on purpose, and used 30 thousandths brass, made myself a little bracket, and as you can see, made a wire with a little curly Q on the back and mounted it in such a way that it makes a perfect pointer and it's fully adjustable to get that center right on. Painted the end with a little bit of red nail polish, and there you have a pointer, and it looks very, very nice, and it's permanent, won't move around, and you could adjust it to exactly what you wanted. So I thought that was a whole lot better than the cheesy sort of magnet and hot melt glue system. So that kind of completes the whole job on the rotary table. So now I have a front dial that I can look at. Makes it easier. I can actually look at it sitting here, as well as when I've got something too big on that rotary table, I can look under here and get everything just where I want it.